This is the day they arrived. Am I the only one having trouble saying aliens? They need to see me.
Dr. Banks?
Now that's a proper introduction.
More objects have landed around the world.
It's their language.
Got 21 hours before they start global war.
They're not our enemy.
We need to talk to them.
It's more complicated than that.
How is it more complicated?
Are you dreaming in their language?
Welcome to Editors on Editing. I'm Glenn Garland. When I last spoke to Joe Walker, he had just finished editing Sicario, for which he was nominated for the Eddie. Joe has also edited such brilliant films as
Shame, Hunger, Harry Brown, and 12 Years a Slave, for which he was nominated for the BAFTA, the Eddie, and the Oscar. He has just been nominated for the BAFTA and the Oscar and won the Eddie for Arrival, his second collaboration with director Denis Villeneuve.
Joe, thank you so much for being with me today. I just loved what you did with The Arrival. It was just fantastic.
Thank you. I'm going to edit that because it's Arrival.
I know, that's right. I always keep saying The Arrival when it's actually Arrival.
I'm so pleased with that film because it's, you know, we set out with a kind of puzzle piece and that it found an audience. It's done very well in the box office, but it also seems to kind of reach the head and the heart in equal doses.
Well, I remember speaking to you maybe 6 months ago, and you were like, I love this film. It's really cool. I just don't know if the audience is going to react to it properly, because it is a very cerebral type of sci-fi movie.
The really pleasing thing, I keep hearing people saw it a second time, because they wanted to, you know, piece it together again, which is great, and they're looking at the plumbing the second time.
This is your second collaboration with Denis. Talk to me a little bit how your relationship has evolved and how it was different on this than Sicario.
A lot of things are different when you have that great film behind you. You know, we were sort of really happy with the result on Sicario, and I found a great match and, you know, worked with him very well and like a brother. And I think, you know, during Sicario, I used to hear these sort of strange phone calls in the back of the cutting room. Denis would always sort of go up to the door and shut the door, and you knew that there was an important phone call coming up. And in the sort of muted voice at the back of the room, he was saying to some creature designers that maybe we should think about having no eyes. And that was the first I heard of the project. And I thought, my God, what is this thing? So, we had this solid film behind it, and the great advantage of that, you have a lot of faith and a lot of trust. And there were definitely times in the edit where he suggested something where I'd say an older software version of myself might have been reticent to approach something that was, you know, from the outset felt doomed to failure. Mm. And in the case of having had this great experiment behind us, just gave it a go and it sort of bore fruit.
Now you heard it. What do you make of it?
Is that?
Yes.
One could all equally talk about the arrival into the spaceship the first time. It felt like we could really tease out that moment and build huge anticipation that's been building right from the beginning of the film.
Yeah, it felt like you were just stretching that rubber band.
Stretching the rubber band as far as we could. And then when we finally confront her with the aliens, it's over very quickly. You don't see much and it's over quickly.
Well, I think the reason why you can take that time is because, like, right before that scene, she's asking about the suit and he's like, you ever scuba dive before? And then instead of walking to get the suit, they're in their suits and they're getting them on. And then at the end of that scene, you may begin and then it's over. Then we cut out. So it's playing with this, like, where do we take the time, where do we like jump ahead and keep ahead of the audience?
I think that's the nice thing, isn't it? To build up tension and then to to go forward a little bit faster. You know, it's a measurement, isn't it? Editing sometimes is a measurement of how you are in relationship to the audience in storytelling terms. And it's nice to be in parallel and then sometimes to skip a little forward, you know, and compress things. And that's the superpower we have.
Sure.
And I think it's also part of a choice of Denis, you know, to create a hunger for, you know, a look at the aliens and to hear the aliens, so that starts right at the beginning of the film. We don't show a news report of a shell landing. We show her, Louise's face in the classroom.
That was great because it's like we hear the whole thing on her face, then the classroom's face, and then we see maybe a tease of it in that wide, wide shot of the classroom.
And when she goes back home as well, we spent more time dwelling on the open space outside her lakeside house than we do on the news clips which she's scrolling through. Mm. So you get a glimpse and it's like just tantalizing, it's peripheral. I mean, the film is about time, and I always, you know, thought that that was kind of a great thing for an editor to get their hands on, but also about timeliness, because the film, you know, in the background, there was much political upheaval, as we all know, in the year that we were making the film. Mm-hmm. So to have a film that's got a strong female lead that respects intelligence and education and doesn't deride it, and is about, has basically a message of unity and tolerance of different folk, mm-hmm. it's extraordinary that that was possible and that it reached an audience. And I'm always grateful for that. Towards the end of the film, we have those two scenes where she meets the general mm-hmm. at a party and gets an idea of what she must do next.
Yes.
Without it being explicit. And originally, and then she goes and tries to find a field phone and make a phone call to him. Mm-hmm. And then quite late in the process, after many two test screenings and after much discussion with Paramount and our producers and Denny, we sort of said, okay, well, let's intercut them. It would be really cool if we don't know what she's going to do, and she doesn't know what she's going to do. All she's got from that first scene before we cut away from it is the phone number. She has no idea what she's going to say. Mm-hmm. And then you intercut him telling her what to say with her doing it.
Sure.
So there's a tension to that, tremendous tension. We had building music. And then, you know,
it was all one scene and then the next.
One thing after another.
Wow.
So in sort of some way, the audience knew exactly what she was going to do, and then she did it.
Mm.
So that's all cool. And then having done that, having built this big sort of building tension, we then felt that there wasn't enough after it as originally planned. We thought, well, we never saw the spaceships arrive, so why don't we have them depart?
And originally they didn't?
No, there was no departure.
With their writing, it's always sort of almost like the silhouette, and there's this beautiful silhouette of Banks and Donnelly in the window, and they're sort of standing at the end, and it almost looks like another piece of language, which I thought was.
I think Bradford is I loved cutting his footage. He's a brilliant cameraman, and the the great choice that they made was this 1.9. They threw everything out of focus. I mean, literally. Her cheek is in focus, her nose is out of focus. It's a very, very tight range. Mm. And they took great advantage of that with many echoing shots. For example, a shot of Ian when they're inside the shell and Louise is drawing on the screen and she's completely blown out of focus. I mean, I think the choice is to focus the film on the central character.
Sure.
And, you know, I'm sure it's something that VFX companies hate, you know, because you could look at any one of those shots of the heptapod and it would be photoreal, beautiful three-dimensional, textured, every little detail. And then we covered it up in mist.
Uh-huh.
Because, you know, Denny wanted to hold back all the time.
Sure.
So that you slowly kind of reveal more and more about this character that you find out.
That's great, because, like, you don't really see the scale of the pods for maybe 15 minutes. You know, it takes a long time before we reveal that.
We're very mean with our exposition now, that's the truth.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we just didn't give it all out at the beginning.
But that keeps you intrigued. It keeps the mystery going. You also feel like you've got these aerials again that were in Sicario, and where you just feel man's very small place in the universe, because we always think of ourselves as very big, but then we realize that we're very tiny.
then he's very keen on those kind of different viewpoints. You know, we had a lot of that in Sicario. Mm-hmm. It's a kind of quite a contemporary view, as is the sort of first-person shooter kind of point of view, which is mm-hmm. often there. It's just following somebody from behind.
Well, tell me about that, because there were a lot of shots where we were following from behind.
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, the standout shot for me is a moment where Louise goes out into the grasslands and the wind is whipping through her hair and she feels sick, you know, from this sort of contamination. Is it contamination or is it a troubling memory of grief? You know, it's an intangible thing. And in the background is this big black out of focus egg.
And then intercutting that with her daughter dying of cancer. Mm-hmm. It feels like she's not anchored, and so intercutting the meadow with that was really interesting.
Yeah, and using, you know, echoing gestures and, you know, touch, and the moment where she sort of lies down next to her daughter in the hospital bed, and just sort of echoing things and trying to make them, you know, just bring out the poetry of them. And then there was this vast bank of material that was beautiful. You know, of the girl pushing stones in the water with a stick that looks almost like a heptapod leg, or mm-hmm. making plasticine a little clue, or, you know, all these things were almost documentary material.
And that wasn't shot for specific?
No. All this intimate stuff with this daughter, and, you know, I always think with the opening of the film, Amy puts her stamp on the film with the first shot. You know, you see her coming towards the girl mm-hmm. with what she calls her tickle guns. And she just wins us over so, you know,
well,
quickly.
That sequence is so economical,
mm.
but you get a real feeling of a life that
whole
meant
life.
Something really powerful.
2.5 minutes long.
And then you fade out to sort of give it a definition at the beginning. And it's very interesting how everything that we saw in that, we put those impressions on who she is as a person now.
That was very carefully calibrated. And my viewpoint had always been, you know, we have 100 and whatever it is years of cinema. And if you start a film with a child dying and then you have a woman walking in grief and then stepping into a classroom, with, you know, that's...
There's a language that has been...
It's a very solid wall that you've got to kick down later.
Mm-hmm.
So we did some work to balance it so that the bricks weren't so firm.
Mm-hmm.
There were some things we cut, for example, at the beginning. There was a scene, for example, where she walked into a spare bedroom and it's empty. And when you see it in the context, you think, you know, that's the child's bedroom.
Mm-hmm.
And we felt actually that's one thing that when you revisit, it's a cheat.
Her learning the alien's language, which is put to us as a nonlinear way of speaking,
mm.
that almost in a way starts unlocking her to have an inability to have foresight. And as an editor, you're editing nonlinear. And so you're, in a way, you know, creating that language that's in her head through your editing.
It was a great moment. Really, one of my favorite moments in the whole cutting experience was there's a scene in the middle which is currently a nightmare. And it starts with Ian coming around with somebody else and talking to Louise and saying, you know, I've been reading about this thing, the Sapir-Whorf theory, that, you know, exposure to a language mm-hmm. could rewire the brain. And then what actually happened was it wasn't written as a, you know, or shot as a nightmare sequence. It was shot as a straightforward sequence. And then it took us down several scenes before she came back on board and then they tried to figure it out together. And we took all that story tubing out because it felt like the middle of the film was sort of bogged down. And we also felt that we were at the critical number of scenes inside the shell. Then it got to the point where we realized there's no articulation of this central idea that exposure to, say, German might affect the way that you think. And normally when, you know, you get to a late stage in post and somebody... We're talking about putting a scene back, having benefited from the increased pace of losing it. I would say that's a bit like putting wet swimming trunks back on. You know, they're always like a couple of degrees colder than your skin, having discarded them. Yeah. A little bit clammy. And it normally is just like through gritted teeth you try and put this stuff back. what actually happened in that case was Denny said, well, let's put it together and let's just take the bits that we need and nothing else. So I know that an older software version of me would probably have said, yeah, but as soon as we cut to Weber, we're going down that rabbit hole. We can't. I didn't say that. We just went for it. And, you know, the first accident of it was that it was two bits of Ian chucked together. And they're very similar shots with a very jarring, to me, a jump cut. Everything in the film is quite smooth. And then we cut to Amy and we had her close up where she's probing off screen very anxiously looking at Weber. And she knows that she's something bad is going to happen. And then we just stopped there and said, well, at the last possible frame where we can hold on to her looking off screen and you're dying to know what Weber's thinking, you then cut round to a heptapod in the bottom of, you know, sitting at the foot of her bed. And then you put a little bit of sound design and we put the canary in it.
Canary chirping.
Yeah, which is a little clue, not as all that it seems. And that first jump cut, I think, is a clue that not all is as it seems. And look at the benefit. You know, we managed to get shoehorn in this kind of vital kind of notion. But we also, I thought, a great benefit was we're inside our lead, you know, lead character's mind. We've talked about this before with Sicario, is we work without temp tracks. So you end up being very mean on the, you know, with the film. It goes through a lot of liposuction. You're very, you know, you make sure that it's the story that's driving the pace of the film.
Sure.
It's not John Williams. But the big side benefit is, first of all, you know, composer has a blank canvas to work with. Mm-hmm. But second of all, you end up giving opportunity to sound and sound design, or, as in the case of Arrival, there's some wonderful moments is of total silence.
When we go inside her mind, you purposely, it felt like you did not have music. You kept it a little bit more dry, and it sort of made it feel a little bit unworldly.
What we did with those was there's that little montage of sequences on the lakeside of the child in her little Wellington boots. And what we did was they're mute. I mean, they're completely mute. That's a moment where you go down to nothing sound-wise. Mm. And then the first...
You hear that rock.
You hear the rock falling and very sharp cut. I found, I don't know, I've got a real predilection for cuts that end hard, as well as starting hard, but I always like things that end hard, a very sort of tough cut.
Before we go into her mind, we hear, what's that word? And we're not in her mind, we're outside her mind, and you're going, wait, that sounded like a voice of a young girl.
Mm.
You also do that with the non-zero-sum game,
mm.
where you play some dialogue in a different perspective than where we are. Sometimes you're hearing Donnelly speak to her, even though we're in her mind, we're hearing it.
Yeah.
And then other times we're at the military base, but we hear something that's going on inside her mind.
Yeah, in a way there's a progression to that point we get to where we're intercutting the Chinese general to the reality and the vision, very, you know, totally intercut. And, you know, by that stage, non-zero-sum game, that's where we're starting to have two parallel worlds. Mm-hmm. And also, it sounds really great in the cinema. There's a little, you know, distance in the spectral positioning of things, I think. I mean, sound is a huge ingredient, and sound is just something that preoccupies me all the time. At that stage, I just had blank screens, and in the daily, sometimes a guy holding a tennis ball on a stick in green lycra. It's never a good look. And, you know, but for the grace of God, go I. And but that was just for eye lines, and there was nothing to indicate duration or time. So you have to kind of, you know, you have to have the balls to hold on to a shot for quite a long time when you're holding on just white screen.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the kind of processes that really helped, you know, keep firm about those things was Dave Whitehead, Michelle Child's sounds, you know. So we hired them very early on the strength of District 9. So we approached Dave very early and said, you know, can you give us these heptapod noises?
Louise, I am Louise.
What was remarkable is it really didn't change. I'm normal, you know, for 6 months, it was, you know, we dug it every time we heard it.
Sure. When they're inside the spaceship in the shell, tell me about the complexity of editing a scene where very little dialogue is being exchanged, you know, and trying to create the tension and knowing how long to hold on things and that sort of thing, and keeping them from being repetitive when we go up into the shell.
It's just basically that. Try and cut things with as little dialogue as possible and stop them being repetitive. I mean, that's the kind of mission.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I'm not against great dialogue, but it feels very cinematic to avoid it sometimes,
mm-hmm.
and to really pare it down, make it super sparse.
So there was more dialogue?
I'm sure there was, yeah. I just know that we sort of like landscape it a bit and just really kind of keep to
the key things.
What's the really key moment? I mean, you just go through this brilliant process. I mean, it's just the greatest job on earth, I think, what we do. We end up scrutinizing,
mm-hmm.
thankfully with some time on our side, and really trying to examine what is the purpose of this scene? What
sure.
is the purpose of this line? What is the purpose of this gesture? What is the purpose of this atmosphere? You know, it's all scrutinized and
sure.
managed very, very carefully in order to kind of deliver, hopefully, the best crafted movie that you can.
Mm-hmm. I love the central idea, which is, you know, if you know your future, or if you know what's going to happen, do you live it anyway?
Mm.
There's something sort of beautiful about that.
At one stage in the story, the big gift was meant to be technology, and there were many meetings about it. Because, you know, Denny Wrightley, I think, didn't want it to be, you know, we're going to give you advanced technology in a spaceship or a design. I mean, it felt kind of, you know, a corny Hollywood thing.
You want to keep it emotional.
Yeah, I mean, I've always described this film as being, you know, an art film in Hollywood tins. And we want to kind of keep that notion that the language is the weapon and the language is the gift. And the language, it reveals, it gives you the key to time.
What was your most challenging part of editing this film together?
I think the biggest challenges were two characters being completely missing in the dailies. And the other challenge was just calibrating a reveal and making sure that everybody was on board without pissing them off.
Sure.
There's always an audience demand to get a wiggle on at the end of a film, because everybody wants a solution and they want, you know, some kind of ending, happy or not. There is a time where you follow the story and people become impatient for the thing to kind of wrap.
Mm-hmm.
And there's that imperative that you feel very much as an editor. But there's also a way of playing and carrying on teasing a little bit. And we did that very much in 12 years. I think, you know, there was a choice to just hold on Solomon's face. It's remarkable. Nothing, not a word of dialogue is said. Nothing happens. It's just a shot of somebody's face listening. And at that point in the film, when you're desperate for some kind of release and finale, to hold off is, I think, audiences can dig that.
When there isn't dialogue, the audience helps to fill in the gap. They start putting their impressions onto that face. And if you've done your job right before, they're putting on the feelings that you want them to have.
These experiments go back, in my professional life, you know, lots of these sort of thoughts started, like with Steve McQueen's first film, Hunger. It's what happens when you starve people of dialogue. You know, you then showcase a huge only dialogue scene.
It's a long dialogue scene, but you're riveted because you've earned it.
And it's held back. It's in one, for the most part, it's in one wide shot, you know, 17 minutes, I think.
Wow.
And what happens is, you know, I find that's another thing I've just discovered that, you know, it's like trying to get a little bit like putting a frame around something so that you stimulate a response that you'd normally get in an art gallery. You know, there's an engagement with the audience peering into something. And I sort of felt like something
rather
like
than
that.
Manipulating them and saying, okay, you're going to pay attention to this and this and this.
Yeah, and when you start thinking like that, a lot of editing really bothers you. I mean, a lot of television editing really bothers me, and it stands in the way of me enjoying a film
mm-hmm.
or a television program, because my hand is being dragged through the story. And I understand the imperatives behind that, but it's also sometimes you just think, I'm getting the information, but I'm not getting the experience or the feeling. I'm not allowed.
Everything was great. Those two lines need to be on screen, you know, because it's like, the audience won't pay attention to it unless that that line is on screen, like, no, we'll still pay attention. In fact, we might pay more attention because what they're saying means more to that character than it does to the character who's saying it.
Yeah, and then you've got a weapon that you know that you can use with great skill is you know, the immediacy of seeing somebody's face, seeing something, selective for the exactly the moment when you want to do it.
Mm-hmm.
When I judge other people's editing, it's not the big action sequences that impress me, although I'm impressed, but mm-hmm. I'm not really seeing the specific skill of a person editing the film. It's the two-handers where you're just cutting two shots together. Mm-hmm. And if it's a long scene, and sometimes the skill of that and keeping our attention.
Absolutely.
And the delicate play between actors and allowing these moments, but also, you know, the craft of kind of skillfully, you know, taking air out of other moments. You've got to sell some to buy others, I think is the kind of phrase I'd use. Mm. And seeing that done skillfully is something, that's what I marvel at.
Well, I thoroughly enjoyed the film and I thoroughly enjoyed talking to you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks again.
Colonel?
You're at the top of everyone's list when it comes to translations.
Priority one. What do they want? Where are they from?
Dr. Banks? Now that's a proper introduction.
We've got 21 hours
before they start global war.
Are you dreaming in their language?
I know what it is.
What is she doing?
Do you trust me?